Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendu Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT based class today. You have the 10th class, the social science, right? And these are basically lectures which are based on NCERT books, right? So you can also study these NCERT books by yourself, and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures also. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, right, for these lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so today's scope of this lecture is basically what we are going to study is we'll continue the discussions what we have started in our last class. Okay, so we'll continue with the discussion with some of the new topics like pressure groups, right, how they are indirect ways of influencing the politics. Like you have different movements in the democracies, right? There were different demands from the different people, right? The people basically formed the pressure groups. So there were pressure groups tactics which were adopted by the democracies, specifically in the phase of struggle. So we learn how those pressure groups and different indirect ways of, pressurizing the government or pressurizing the king to adopt certain democratic principles is being noted here. All right. So let's understand some of the popular movements in the Nepal. So first of all, let us go for the brief background. What was happens in the Nepal? Okay, let us understand first of all what happens is a bit before 2006. So that movement was started in 2006, but let us start with 2001. Okay, a bit background. So in 2001, what happens is, you know, the economic and the political situation basically was good. It was progressive in the Nepal, right? Despite of having some issues like corruption, nepotism, and there was also issue like moist insurgency, okay, and this ultimately led to a nationwide civil war, right, in 2001. And now what happens is the civil war like situation between the moist insurgents as well as the government of Nepal. Okay, now what happens is this led to the ultimately the assassination of the Nepalese royal family, King Gyanendra, right? And ultimately the assassination of royal, family was ultimately assassinated, and King Gyanendra basically took over or took control of the government, right? And the King Gyanendra, who basically took over the government, right, after 2001, right, he basically continued to rule the country till 2006, right? So he basically continued to govern the country through emergency powers, right? So he had basically enforced the nationwide operation, right? Operation on the media, on the civil society. So there was no such, the rights which were given. So it was totally the emergency power which was adopted by the King Gyanendra. So what happens is there was widespread protest, right? And there was basically, headed by a coalition of seven Nepalese parties. These seven Nepalese parties was basically, alongside with the moist, led to ultimately, the huge pressure on the King Gyanendra. And what happens is this led to resignation of the king, right? And ultimately the King Gyanendra resigned, and ultimately, the parliament was reinstated because the parliament was dissolved by the King Gyanendra. So the parliament was reinstated, and there was abolition of the monarchy at that point of the time. And there was a transition of the Nepal specifically towards the Federal Republic, right? So that was the end of the civil war in that point of the time. So in short, what you can say that there was no Nepali movement in 2006, right? The movement was basically aimed at the restoring of the democracy, okay? And the King Birendra basically accepted the constitutional monarchy. But the King Virendra, he himself was killed, right? As I told you that it was a civil war and the moist insurgency was there. So King Virendra himself was killed, right, under the mysterious circumstances. So it was the assassination in the royal family in 2001. So after King Virendra, who was killed, right, the King Gyanendra, right, took over the reign of the King of the Nepal, and he was not prepared to adopt the democratic rule. So In what happens in 2005, the king Gyanendra basically dismissed the prime minister and dissolved the parliament in 2005, right? He basically governed from 2001 up to 2005, effectively up to 2006. But in 2005, he basically dissolved, you know, the parliament. And what happens is, this has ultimately led to, you know, the huge protest, right? Even the protesters basically reached to, you know, you understand, up to 5 lakh people. So there was, you know, to retain back the popular control, the 7 political party, I told you, right? They formed the 4-day strike in the Kathmandu, that was the country's capital, right? And the number of protesters basically reached to 3 to 5 lakhs on the 21st April, and that was ultimatum to the king, and ultimately the king accepted, right? So that was the then, and the demands were basically fulfilled, right? For the basically, you know, for the Federal Republic, and ultimately, you know, the last day of ultimatum, what happens is, the Prime Minister Girija Prasad Koirala, right, acted as a new Prime Minister, which was for the purpose of entering government, and this was also known as the Nepal's second movement for the democracy, specifically in the name the Nepalese background. Okay, next let us understand about the Bolivia. Okay, the Bolivia, first of all, let us understand again, just like in Nepal, I'll give you a brief background about the Bolivia. Okay, so first of all, let us understand, a Bolivia is very basically a poor country which is situated in the Latin America. So it is a poor country in the Latin America, right? And the popular struggle basically, which was started, right, in the Bolivia, in the specifically in the city of, you know, Cochabamba. In the Cochabamba, the popular movement was started, right? And that was basically reflect the power of, you know, the public demonstrations and the will of the people specifically. And you can also observe the people's participation as an integral aspect of the democracy, specifically in the Bolivia. So what happens is, I'll let you know. So what happens is, a popular struggle there of the Bolivia that was started in the city of Cochabamba, right? That was, you know, when the World Bank basically pressurized the government at that point of the time, right, to give up the control of the municipal water to the city, because that was the time when the popular agitation was there, because the prices of the water was gone up. So it was, you know, the water prices which ultimately led to the agitation. So World Bank basically pressurized the government to give up the control of the municipal water, right, specifically in the cities. And what happens is, the rights were basically sold to the multinational companies, and that ultimately led to the rising of the prices of the water. So what happens is, this multinational company, right, that were assigned the rights to sold, right, the water, immediately what happens, this multinational company has no motive to serve the people of the Bolivia. So what happens is, right, the water prices were basically hiked by 4 times. You can understand, 4 times the water prices was hiked, and water is the most vital asset. Without water, we cannot survive, isn't it? So at that point of the time, monthly bill, you know, people basically went up to 1,000 rupees, right? You can understand, right? And the average income was around 5,000. So 1/5 of their bill or expenses basically belongs to the water. So they were very costly, right? If you provide, or if you, you know, expand, or you know, your expenses 1/5 for the water, obviously what will you save? So what happens is, this ultimately led to the huge protest, and you know, and basically an alliance was formed. This alliance is known as FEDECOR. It is also written here, the FEDECOR. This alliance basically consisting of the labor, right, the human rights, community leaders, they basically formed an organization that is called FEDECOR. And there was 4-day strike, and the government comes under the pressure, and the government was ready to negotiate at the first. So the movement was basically called off because the government was ready to negotiate. But even after negotiation, no further steps was taken, right, specifically. And again, the strike started beginning, right? And when the second time strike started, the police basically came down very heavily on the protesters. So very brutally, they were beaten up. Okay, then the strikes continued after that, and there was huge violence, and the government of Bolivia has no other option but to impose the martial law. So the martial law was basically imposed in the Bolivia, And you know what happens is the power of the people eventually force the officials, that because of the huge violence was there, so the officials belongs to the MNC was basically flee the city, right? Because they were suspicious, or they were basically thinking that they might get also killed in that process. So they fled the country, and ultimately the government also agreed to accept the demands of the people. And ultimately the protest, their work, their huge labor actually bore the fruit. And the contract which was given to the MNC, which is rising to the prices of the water to the 4 times, the contract was cancelled, and the water was basically restored to the municipalities, right, at the older rates which were previously there, right? So this was simply movement or the mobilization in the Bolivia. So understand, the Bolivia is basically a poor country in the Latin America. Okay, so it was not led by a political party. That was, I was telling you, it was against the privatization of the water that I was explaining you just now. Okay, I hope you would have understand. And in that process, the FEDECOR was basically set up. It was consisting of the engineers, environmentalists, local professionals, right, other peoples. And obviously the movement was supported by the Socialist Party. And ultimately this party came into the power in the Bolivia in 2006 when this revolution was occurring. Okay, and you can understand how the different kind of work, right, different kind of organization work behind this big struggle, right? So obviously the one obvious way of influencing the decisions in the democracy is direct participation. So here the people directly participated, as you have seen also the people from every corner, because now they have seen that 1/5 of their money will be spent on the water. What will they save for the family? So ultimately they came on the roads and ultimately started protesting. Okay, and there are many indirect ways by which people can get also the government to listen, right? Because they have formed some sort of alliances, they have formed some sort of pressure groups, which basically ultimately bore the fruit and ultimately led to the winning of this struggle. So let us understand now these pressure groups. Okay, now pressure groups and the movement. So first of all, what is this pressure groups? Okay, now pressure groups, first of all, they are not political groups. Okay, their main purpose is not to fight the elections, but their main purpose is to attempt to influence the government policies, right? So they don't have the motto like coming to the power and winning the elections. No, but they have influence, or they have main motto to influence the government policies, right? So they are formed when the people have the common interest, right? They have the common occupation, common aspirations, common opinions. They come together, right? And they have some common objective. So commonness is most important thing for any pressure groups to be formed. So if they have the common motto, common goal, common occupation, common interest, common aspirations, then they come together and ultimately they form an association that is called pressure group. Ultimately the main idea is to influence the government policies. So definitely there are sectional interest groups, right, which are there, right? And public interest group. What is the difference between the sectional interest group and the public interest group? That you must understand, right? So first of all, the interest groups basically seeks to promote the interest of particular group. For example, if there is any group, right, so that group basically seeks to promote the interest of a particular group, particular section, particular society, right? And their participation, or they usually motivated by the betterment of their lifestyle, right? The betterment of their own members, right? They are not concerned about the society in general, but their main concern about their own group, right? Their group is also part of the society. Okay, so that is what we call them sectional interest group, right? And you must also understand, because sometimes some organization may not be bothering about, right, the whole society, right, but they are mainly concerning of the interest of one section of the society. Okay, so there are two aspects. One side you have the public interest, you have another side your sectional interest. The public interest basically covers up all public, right, which were residing in a particular social strata. But in the sectional groups, there were sections, right, there were mainly concerned about promotion of the particular interest of a particular section, the group of society. So section is a smaller, right, but you say when the public at a large, that is a bigger in terms of the area, in terms of the population. So section is a part of your society, first of all. So any sectional interest is basically promoted by the sectional interest groups. Okay. Next, these second type of groups are called promotional groups or public interest groups. So what they have collective goods. So they have collective, you know, motto, right? They are not concerned to any particular section, but they are mainly concerned to the collective rights. They are mainly concerned to the collective fundamental rights, right? So what happens is their main aim is to help, you know, groups, right? Other than other groups also, other than other members also. So they were mainly concerned about the collective rights, the collective privilege, the collective interest, right? All such things are basically also known as the public interest groups. Now, next is basically your movement groups. Okay. So the movement groups are basically involved in some sense, some sort of a, you know, with the movement. So, you know, the movements are basically maybe issue, some sort of issue specific. For example, you may have the woman empowerment, you have the child, you know, the protection, or you have, you may have the protection against, you know, atrocities against SCST. So that type of movement, or you may have the protection movement against the casteism, right, the communalism. So all sort of movements are basically against issue specific. A particular issue is surrounding that movement or that group of the people, that is called movement groups. Okay, so they have to seek and you know, to achieve a single objective, right? That too basically limited period of the time. So they have certain predefined objectives they have to achieve for that. And you know, you must understand, for example, there are tribal groups in the society, right, which were which were basically displaced by infrastructural projects. For example, a classic case study, you can say Sardar Sarovar Dam, which was set up in the Narmada River, right? Thousands of the tribals basically displaced, right? So Narmada Bachao Abhiyan was basically an NGO which was formed ultimately to protect the rights of the tribal people, isn't it? So objective of to stop, objective of this Narmada Bachao Abhiyan, or to promote this, you know, the welfare of the tribal people, to stop the dam from being constructed, because a lot of the, you know, the devastation related to the ecosystem, you know, biodiversity will also be taken place, as well as, you know, the tribal peoples will also be migrated from there. They will also be displaced. Many of those will lose their livelihood, isn't it? And they are basically single issue based, right? And you may have certain set of long-term movements, right, which involve more than one issues. For example, you have our freedom struggle movement that was basically there, right? So pressure groups and the movements basically exert influence on the politics on the variety of the ways, right? So their main aim is to not to come to the power, but to basically achieve certain objectives in that process, right? So they try to always try to gain the public support, the public sympathy, right, the public attention, the public gaze, because they will work basically among the public, right? So they basically carry out very various tasks. Like, for example, they basically carry out the information campaigns to inform the publics, right? They organize meetings, protest, file petitions, right, before the concerned authorities, right? There are ways by which they can basically adopt these pressure tactics, right? They often also organize the protest activities like strikes, disrupting the government programs, and so on and so forth, right? And they also adopt sometime, you know, professional lobbyist or the sponsor, right, for, you know, various expensive advertisements, right, for the purpose of seeking their goals to be fulfilled in that direction. Okay, and in some instances, right, so the pressure groups either, you know, led by leaders of the political parties or act as an extended arm of political parties sometime, but this is not, you know, universal, but now it is, because of the political, you know, excess, right? What happens is the political leaders are also having certain linkages with those pressure groups. They are entirely not insulated from the politics, right? So sometime the political party grew out of the movements, sometime that may happen. Okay, so there are certain, you know, relationship between the parties and those movements also not to be ruled out. So they may have certain linkages between them also. So now let us understand, is this every influence is healthy? So first of all, obviously not. They are not healthy for the groups, right? For the group that promote the interest of one section to have influence on them in the democracy. So that is, you know, for the sectional interest, right? So, sometimes, it will appear that the group is mainly interested in the power without any responsibility, right? So, sometimes what happens is these pressure groups in the movement, they may not get the funds, right? And the support from the people. Sometimes that the people are also susceptible about their motto, their goals, their aims, right? And sometimes if these pressure groups and the movements put the pressure on the rulers, say democratically elected government, right? Sometimes they are not healthy, because if you see in the Kundankulam, which is a nuclear power plant in Tamil Nadu, right? Lot of protest is openly going on with the support of NGOs. So sometimes it is not healthy activity, right? As long as, it is having certain, other aspect, right? So the public interest groups, movements, basically, they perform a useful role, definitely, but they have to be, concerned with some sort of other aspects also. Okay, now let us understand the political parties. As you know, in any democracy, the role of the political parties are huge, right? Without political party, the democracy cannot sustain, very well. Okay, so what is the role of a political party? First of all, let us understand. See, a political party may be a group of people, right, which are basically having the aspiration to come to the power, right, in the winning of the elections. So you can basically demarcate these political parties as a national party or as a basically state party. Okay, so the Election Commission of India basically have come, right, basically for the purpose of the demarcation, right? What criteria should be there, right, to demarcate them as a political party? So you can see here, there is clear demarcation, right, which have been made by the Election Commission of India to demarcate, right, demarcate as a basically, as a national party or as a, state parties, right, in India. So you can see a party that secured at least 6% of the total votes, right? So if they secure at least 6% of the total votes in the Lok Sabha or in the assembly elections in at least 4 states, and along with that, they should also win at least 4 seats in the Lok Sabha. Such political parties will be recognized at basically your, basically your national party. Okay, right. So this is what, you must understand. Then second, a state party. The state party is something who secure at least 6% of the total votes in the elections of the legislative assembly, right? And it should also win at least 2 seats, right? That is basically something to be recognized as, as a basically the state party in the state, right? Now, there are other criterias also. Now, if you want to listen, you can also listen. What are the other criteria? For example, a registered party is recognized as a national party if it fulfills any of the 3 conditions. What are they? If the party should win at least 2% of the seats in the Lok Sabha from at least 3 different states. That has been recently added by the Election Commission of India. Or in a general election to the Lok Sabha or in the Legislative Assembly, if the party polls 6% of the votes in any 4 or more states, right? And in addition, it should also win 4 Lok Sabha seats. Such party will also recognize as a national party. Third criteria, if the party gets recognition as a state party in the 4 states, then such party can also be recognized as a political party, as a national party. And the fourth and the last, that is, if the party gets at least 8% of the total valid vote pools in at least 4 or more states, right? So, so that party can also be recognized as a national party. So certain other aspects have been recently been added by the Election Commission of India, right? Since this is your 10th class, so they have not been added in this, but as you graduate in a higher class, you will also learn that one. Okay, regarding the state party, I'll also explain. So Election Commission of India, first of all, recognize the state party. So any party who has to fulfill any of the following conditions will be recognized, the state party. The first is basically, if the party should ensure at least 6% of the valid vote votes in the election of the state legislative assembly and at least win 2 seats, that is recognized state party. That is the first condition. Second condition, the party should secure at least 6% of the valid vote votes in the election to the Lok Sabha, and win at least 1 seat in the Lok Sabha. Such political party can also be recognized as a state party. Third, a party should win minimum 3% of the total number of seats, right? Or a minimum of 3 seats in the legislative assembly, right? Whichever is higher should be recognized as a political party or a state party, right? Or a party who should win at least 1 seat in the Lok Sabha for every 25 seats or in that fraction will also be recognized as a state party. And the last, right? You know, if the party secures 8% or the more of the total voted votes polled in the state, then party will also be recognized as a state party. So these other aspects have been recently been added by the Election Commission of India. Now, why do we need the political party? First of all, this is a question that will come into your mind. So first of all, the political parties are needed, right? For, you know, they are the most vital institutions in the democratic framework, like in our country. Right. So the parties can become identified with the social divisions, with the political divisions. For example, we have right, we have left, we have center, right? All such political divisions are there. Okay. Now, about 100 years ago, there was a few countries of the world that has any political party. But now, almost every country has the political party. There are very few who do not have the party. Otherwise, every country has the political party. So let us understand the meaning of the political party. So first of all, a political party is a group of people. Is a group of people. That means it consisting of the group of people, right? That came together. The purpose of the political party of the or those group of the people is to contest the elections. Why they want to contest the elections? In order to win the seats and ultimately govern. Ultimately to come into the power and form the government. Okay. So what happens is these members or this group of the people or the political members, basically they agree on some policies and the programs for the society, right? And they were basically instrumental in promoting these collective goods for the society. So they were basically promoting these collective goods to the society, specifically for the betterment of society, right? These parties basically reflect the fundamental political divisions in the society. Okay, sometimes the parties are basically involved in partnerships also, and ultimately form, you know, the coalition government, right? Now you have, for example, NDA government, which is also coalition government. You previously have the UPA government, which was also the coalition government. Okay, currently you have the political parties. You have three components in any political party. The first is leader. The leader of a political party would alone be appointed as a PM if it has a central level, or the leader of a political party at the state level will only be appointed as a CM, right, or chief minister. Then you have active members. These active members may be appointed as a ministers. Okay. Then you have followers. These followers are basically, you know, they basically support the political party from outside. Okay. Then you have partisanship. So a partisan is a person basically, right, who are strongly committed to the political party or to a political group. Okay. So a party is about the society they involve in some certain set of partisanship. The role of opposition party, you know very well that in any democracy, the role of opposition is very vital. Without opposition, the democratic functioning of a political party is almost impossible. Right. So in democracy, the opposition party would bring the constructive criticism to the government. They provide a constructive criticism. Right. The opposition party mobilizes the oppositions to the government. Right. They put forward some of the defects in the policies of the government. They criticize the government. They basically bring back some of the issues related to corruptions, delay in the government policies. Right. They force the government to implement certain progressive measures. Right. And ultimately, they can also keep check on the ruling parties also. OK, then let us understand what is the ideological differences or what are the inspiration for the different political parties. So we are just taking 3-4, you know, the big political parties. So let us understand about Bharatiya Janata Party. So Bharatiya Janata Party is basically the source of inspiration is the ancient Indian culture in the venue. So they were mainly concentrated or they were mainly rooted in the ancient Indian culture and the values, right? The cultural nationalism, that is the Hindutva, is an important element for the politics for the Bharatiya Janata Party. So they were mainly focusing on the cultural nationalism, right? That is the conception of the Indian nationhood and the politics with respect to the BJP. Okay. Next is Bahujan Samaj Party, that is Mayawati, right? So Bahujan Samaj Party, basically, you know, they have inspired from the ideas, teachings of, you know, certain the social reformers, right? You have the Savu Maharaj, Mahatma Phule, Dr. Ambedkar, Ramaswamy Naikar. They were basically involved in, the upliftment of the downtrodden members of the society, untouchables, right? Their social, you know, welfare, all such inspirations are basically led to the Bahujan Samaj Party to come to the power. So it stands for the interest and the welfare of the Dalits and oppressed people, including, you know, the minorities and other backward caste also. Okay, then let us understand the ideology of Indian National Congress. As you know that, under the leadership of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, right? So, the Indian National Congress want to build a modern secular society, a modern secular democratic republic in India. So, in that purpose, right, our country is also a secular country, and the party or Indian National Congress basically always propagates the secularism, and they also believe in the welfare of the weaker sections and the minority of India, and definitely in that process, they also support the economic reforms for the country. Now, let us understand there are three kinds of the party systems that are found in the world. I'm talking in the world. First of all, one party system. One party system means there are only one party in any country, right? Only one party, that is by default party that will govern the whole country, right? For example, in China, there is only one party system, that is Communist Party of China, that is called CPC, right? So in the CPC, there are only party which govern the country, right? Then you have the two-party system. In the two-party system, right, several party may exist and contest elections, right, and only few seats or win a few seats in the national legislature. For example, in the USA, in the UK, specifically in the USA, the classic example, you have the Democrats, right, at one side, and you have another party on the other side, right. So you have, you know, the two-party system which are found or which are working in the USA. Right, then you have the multi-party system. In the multi-party system, like India, you have lot of political party, you have multi-party, you have different political parties which are found in India. Okay, so different political parties are found. For example, in India you have BJP, Congress, BSP, Trinamool Congress, Shiv Sena, and apart from that, they are also coalition partners also. For example, you have National Democratic Alliance, which is basically, you know, the BJP and associated coalition partners. Then you have United Progressive Alliance, UPA, that is basically the Congress and associated alliance partners, right? So obviously, you know, the multi-party system sometime also bring the political instability sometime, but it's also good because it basically concerned with the interests and opinions of certain weaker sections of the society. They basically take care, they cater their needs, their, you know, political needs, political aspirations, right? All such things are basically good, but definitely they may also provide the political instability, right? There is no guarantee that the political the policies may continue after the government changes. Okay, now let us understand the functions. So first of all, every political party is a very, you know, vital institution in any democracy. So they basically exercise various functions, right? So various political powers they have. So series of the functions are there. So first of all, they basically contest elections. In the contesting elections, in the most of the democracies, wherever you go, the political parties basically contest the election in the name of political parties, right? And they basically stand their, you know, their candidates, their own candidates, right? This candidate basically fought the elections and ultimately either win or lose the elections. Then the parties who come to the power, they have put forward their own policies and programs, right? And based on the manifesto, sometimes the parties are not in the power, they basically propose, you know, some of the manifestos they promise to the people, to the electorates, right? Whenever they come to the power, they would basically, you know, bring that type of policy. So the voters ultimately choose those political parties, right? Based on their manifesto, based on their, you know, the real work that they have done on the ground, based on perception, based on the ideology, based on, you know, in India, the voting pattern is based on the caste, religion, right? There are various other aspects also. So right? And the political parties, they also play a very decisive role in the making of the law for the country. For example, every political party basically govern the country, and in that governance, they basically frame the law. They basically makes the law, and these laws are basically passed in the legislature. For example, you have the Lok Sabha, and you have the Raj Sabha at the central level, and the state level, you have the Legislative Assembly, right? And you have the Legislative Council basically at the state level, right? So in that process, they basically pass the law, and ultimately the political parties, they form and run the government. For example, currently you have the NDA, which is the BJP and its constitute. They basically form and running the government, right? They're governing the country, and they basically bring policy decisions, right? So they were called the political executives. They are also called non-permanent executives. Why they are called non-permanent executives? Because they change after every 5 years. There is elections, and these political parties, they form the government based on their popularity in the lower house only, not on the popularity on the upper house. So government formation is based on the majority seats they have achieved in the Lok Sabha at the central level, as well as the state legislative assembly in the state level. Okay, so those political party who lose the elections, definitely they become an opposition party. So they bring the constructive criticism against the government, against the policies, right? They basically force the government to adopt certain welfare policies, right? They also inform the citizenry, like the electorates, regarding the ill policies, regarding the ill intention of the government, right? This is one of the best way to ensure the accountability and enforceability on the government of the day, right? And definitely the parties basically shape the public opinion, because they were also one of the important vehicle for the information campaign, right? The political parties, their workers basically are among the people, so they will basically shape the public opinion. They highlight the issue, they raise the issues, right? And the demand for the fulfillment of those issues, right? For example, there are various activists, there are members who basically spread all over the country, and they basically, demand for various such issues. And also the parties provide the people the access to the government machinery, right? That is also there. And there are also welfare schemes which are implemented by the government in that process. Okay, now let us understand what is the necessity of this political party. It is of necessity in the democratic country, right? Because in the democratic country, we need the political party because they perform certain functions. Who will perform those functions? So on behalf of the people, we sent the elected representatives that are called basically MPs or MLAs, isn't it? These MPs basically reach to the Lok Sabha and reach to the Raj Sabha, okay? And these MLAs basically reach to the Legislative Assembly, right? And there, these basically MPs and MLAs form the government. Some of the MPs and MLAs basically form the part of the legislature. Some become part of your executive and ultimately govern the country, right? So definitely, the rise of the political party is directly linked to the emergence of the representative democracy. In our country, we have adopted the representative democracy. What is representative democracy? In the representative democracy, right, we are the members of the parliament or member of legislative assembly. They are the representatives of the people. We chose them, we select them, and we send them to the legislative houses like parliament or legislative assembly. We ask them you to govern on behalf of us, because we select you, right? So they are called representatives of the people. So that is the democracy. They are called representative democracy. All right, and we have also seen large scale societies which need the representative democracy, because such representation would basically enable the democracy to become vibrant and broad based, right? Which also include all participation of all sections of the society. And definitely the political party fulfill the needs of every representative government that they have, because they have to get the votes. And if they do not fulfill those aspirations, definitely they will not get votes, right? So how many parties should we have? That is the one question. So any group of citizen is free to form a political party in India, right? Anyone can form a political party in the formal sense, right? They may have the larger political party in any country, right? And for example, if you see in India, more than 750 parties are basically registered with the Election Commission of India. Okay. And only one party is allowed to control or allowed to govern the country allowed to run the government, then it is called one party system that we have seen, like Communist Party of China. In China, the CPC basically is having the one party rule. Okay, and the one party rule is not good because it is not broad based, it is not inclusive, it is not, you know, a representative, it is not, you know, fulfill those aspirations of the weaker sections of the society, right? So in the democratic option, in the democratic framework, right, we should not go for the one party rule like China, right? So in the democratic system, we must have at least two parties on the multi-party system. So what we have adopted, or what our founding fathers have adopted, is multi-party system, right, where a lot of political parties are there. They basically compete among themselves and they basically come to the power based on the elections that are basically held on the ground, like people chose them, people chose their member, and ultimately based on the election result, they will basically form the government, right? So in the country, the power usually changes between the two main parties, right? Generally in India, for example, the Congress or in the BJP, like the two political parties, basically the powers are basically exchanged, and such type of things are basically called two-party system. In the USA, they are two-party system, okay? And in the several countries, you have the multi-party system, like India, right? In India, you have the multi-party system, as I said just now, the more than 750, you know, the political parties are basically registered with the Election Commission of India, which is also most important aspect, okay? And the several parties in the multi-party system, they basically join the hands for the purpose of contesting elections, and such are called alliances or front. Sometimes they are also called coalition government. They form basically coalition government because they form the bare minimum, you know, strategy to come to the power, right? They basically come to an agreement, they come to the alliance, right? And ultimately they contest the election, ultimately for the purpose of winning and coming to the power, right? So sometimes this multi-party system, they appears to be messy because it provides instability in the political makeup and the political, you know, sphere. There is no guarantee of the, you know, continuation of the policy with the changes of the government, with the changes of, you know, the coalition partner. The policy may also get changed. So sometimes this political party or this multi-party system, they appear very, very messy, right? But definitely the multi-party system has inherent benefit also, right? Because it will cater to the needs of the various sections of the society, right? It basically very broad-based. It basically takes the opinion of every political member, every representations have been taken place, and it is also possible to give the representation to the weaker sections of the society through a multi-party system. All right, so now let us understand the national political parties. So as I've told you that there are various criteria by which we can declare the political party as a national party, or you can declare the political party as a state party, right? There are two kinds of party, the national parties, which are also known as, you know, the federal parties. They represent only one type of federal units or the federal label, okay, and they are registered with the Election Commission. So in India, it is registered with the Election Commission of India, right, for that purpose. And these parties get privilege and certain other facilities based on the recognition, right? Once they recognize the national party, they got certain other benefits, right? And some parties are called recognized political parties because they get recognition by the Election Commission of India. Okay, currently instead of six, it is the old data, you have eight national parties. You have eight national parties. Okay, what are those eight national parties? For example, the first is basically the, you know, it is not given here. You can understand also, you can edit all, right? The Trinmool, right? Congress. Our full name is All India Trinamool Congress, which is led by Mamata Banerjee, already you know. Then second is Bahujan Samaj Party, right? Then third is basically Bharatiya Janata Party, which is this one, okay? Then basically the Communist Party of India, right? Which is basically this party, so it is also covered. Then you have the Communist Party of India Marxist, right? Which is also, this is covered. Okay, then you have Indian National Congress or Nationalist Congress Party, right? So Indian National Congress is also covered. Okay, then you have the National People's Party, right? National People's Party. It is basically led by P.A. Sangma, right? And the next is basically the Nationalist Congress Party. It is basically led by the Sharad Pawar, right? And as you already know about the Indian National Congress, right? It is led by, you know, already, you know, lot of people, but currently, you know, the Sonia Gandhi is basically, you know, by default, she is, you know, running this party. Then you have the Communist Party of India, Marxist, right, which is basically led by, right, lot of people like P. Sundaraiya, M.S. Nambudiripiyar, Jyoti Basu, okay. And then you have the Communist Party of India. The Communist Party of India is basically led by lot of people, right, like Sripad Ambedkar, S.B. Ghate, Muzaffar Ahmed, right. They were basically Shaukat Usmani, they were basically some of the founding fathers of those party. The BJP, already you know very well, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, right, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Lal Krishna Advani, they were basically patron or, you know, the founding fathers. Then Bahujan Samaj Party, not Mayawati, but Kashiram who founded this one. But currently, the Mayawati is having, you know, the by default. And the All India Trinamool Congress is founded by the Mamata Banerjee, and party leader is also Mamata Banerjee. Okay. Current party leader of BJP is basically, you know, JP Nadda or Jagat Prakash Nadda. Okay. The Communist Party of India, the current leader is basically D. Raja. The Communist Party of India, Marxist, the current leader is Sitaram Yechuri. Okay. The Indian National Congress, the interim president is Sonia Gandhi, already I have explained you. In the National People's Party, the interim president is basically the Konrad Sangma. Okay, and the Nationalist Congress Party, the basically leader is Sharad Pawar. Alright. And some of the parties like Biju Janata Dal, Sikkim Democratic Front, Mizo National Front are basically also called having their associated with the state parties, right? So state parties, there are a lot of state parties are there. Okay. So these state parties are basically, you know, based on certain other aspect that I've already told you, that they have certain, you know, the method by which the state, the Election Commission of India had adopted to declare as a party as a state party. Okay. So party like Samajwadi Party, Samta Party, Rashtriya Janata Dal, there are a lot of parties. Other parties like Aam Aadmi Party led by Arvind Kejriwal, All India Anna Dravida, Munitra Kazakam, that is also called AIADMK, that is, you know, led by O Paneerselvam, right? The Idali K Panis, you know, Palani Swami. Then you have All India Forward Bloc, that is basically led by, right, the Debrata Biswas. Then you have All India Majlis-e-Ittehad Musliman, that is led by Asaduddin Owaisi. Then All India NR Congress, that is basically led by N Rangaswamy, right? So lot of state parties are there. Okay, now let us understand the challenges to the political party. What are the challenges to the political parties? So first of all, you must understand, the people basically express their strong dissatisfaction with the failure of the political parties to perform their functions, right? Because the people basically who chose those members, ultimately they came to the power, right, in that process, right? And the people ultimately has the power to ultimately, you know, show their dissatisfaction with the working of those political party, right? If they do not perform well, right? The first challenge is basically the internal democracy within the political party. It is sometime, you know, it is seen that the one person is basically controlling the party, right? They are controlling the many decisions. Almost every decision is taken by, you know, sometime one man, you know, the party, right? There were various, you know, the issues also, the internal democracy of the party. The decisions which are taken within the party are not broad-based, but only the few people, one or two people basically take the, you know, the decisions, majority. So this is again, you know, a problematic part which should be understood. Okay, and there is concentration of the power in one of the few leaders. I don't want to name, but you can also understand in the BJP, only few people take the decisions. In the Congress also, few people take the decisions. It is not based on the internal democracy, but it is based on simply concentration of the power in the hand of the few people. Right, the leaders basically assume the greater power to make the decision in the name of party. Okay, and here also you must understand that the few leaders exercise paramount power in any party, right? So, you know, those who basically disagree with those leaders, they would ultimately resign from the political party because it will be very difficult for them to continue in the political party. The second challenge is dynastic succession. You might have seen also in the Congress especially, right? The basically Gandhi family who basically having the dynastic succession, right? So that is also, you know, one of the important aspect, right, which is the political party do not practice open, but it is something is also going on in the BJP also, if you see the local level also, right? The third challenge basically is about the growing role of money and the muscle power. There is, you know, the nexus between the criminals and politicians, right? This criminals and politicians nexus ultimately led to, you know, the lapse of the democratic functioning of the government, right? That is what is happening. So that is also one of the most important and troublesome aspect here in this process. Okay, then rich people and the companies who generally give the fund, donate the funds, right? So there is also, you know, you have the capitalist and the government or politicians, right? Basically, they have nexus for their own benefit, right? They tend to influence the policies and the decisions of the party because they are used to donate the funds, right? Sometimes the politicians also support the criminals. So there is politicians and criminal nexus, right? And the fourth challenge basically that they don't provide, you know, the meaningful choice to the voters, which is also most important aspect. Now, dynastic succession, I've already told you, dynastic succession means the father and their son ultimately become the leader. So it is most of the political party do not practice in open, right? But there are other ways, right? You can also find out at the local level, right? These dynastic successions are also going on, right? Which is also unfair practice, right? Which basically, you know, do not allow other leaders to come to the power or to take the decisions. Only one party, only one family will take the majority decisions, right? The top positions are always controlled by the members of a particular family, which is very unfair, right, for the internal democratic functioning of any political party, right? How the political parties are formed, you already knows about that one, okay? So lot of effort have been put, right, in that process, right? And the constitution are basically amended to prevent the elected MPs and MLAs to change the parties, that is based on the defection. So we have we have anti-defection law, right, which basically restrict or stop certain set of defections, right? And this is done mainly to stop the elected representatives to indulge in certain set of defections, right? Specifically for the purpose of cash or for the purpose of, you know, the power. The Supreme Court passed an order to reduce the influence of the money and the criminals, but still there is huge scope for you know, for the money power, for the criminals, right, entering into the politics, right? If you see the data, there are a lot of politicians who have, you know, basically having the tainted record in terms of the murder charge, rape charge, and a lot of other issues are also there. Right, the Election Commission has also passed an order making it necessary for the political party to hold their organizational elections and file an income tax return. But again, this is of no use, right? And there should be a law that should regulate the internal affairs of the political party. That is the most important thing. And it should be made compulsory for the political party to govern based on that law, right? Its own internal affairs and own internal democracy should be maintained, right? It should be mandatory for every political party to give a minimum number of tickets, about 1/3, to the woman candidate. It should be made, right? Why only for the woman? It should be also made for, you know, for basically other weaker sections of the society also, right? And there should be state funding of the elections. Many committees have been set up that instead of outside funding, the state should fund the elections. So there is state funding of the elections, and by that we can control some sort of election expenses. We can also reduce the scope of the corruptions specifically in this elections of the political party, because crores of the rupees basically spent during the elections. Okay, but definitely these suggestions have not been accepted by the political parties. So there is huge problem, because the political party themselves are not coming forward for their reform in their functioning, right? Because they themselves are indulged in certain set of corrupt practices. All those things are basically led to, you know, the weakening of our democratic structure, and that is also blot on our democracy, right? So here the political party should be reformed, right? And the people can come out, they should put pressure on the political party, right? So they can do so through the petition, publicity and agitation, that whatever the way the people want to do, because in the democracy, the people is ultimately having the power. The people are ultimately the source of the power, right? The people is ultimately source of the power, right? Isn't it? So that is the beauty of our democratic system. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet tomorrow. Thank you very much. Take care of yourself because of Corona. Thank you very much.
Thank you.